beyond the Inner Harbor. There are anchor institutions all across the city that we can develop around. The 21st Century Schools Plan, which is going to renovate every school building in our portfolio, will mean that renovation is going to come, or development is going to come to neighborhoods across the city, and we can actually bundle development there, especially when we think about vacant houses.
Thank you, Mr. McKesson. Mr. Young, plan for vacant housing in Baltimore.
So when I think about vacancies in Baltimore, you know, I think the first thing that we have to do is we have to prioritize which ones are going to have, what's going to happen to each one. So vacants should either be knocked down, they should be repurposed, or they should be reinvested in. So as mayor, one of the first things that I plan to do that for every vacant that's in the city, and every vacant lot, and every vacant home. For those that have to get knocked down, we use the funding that's been allotted and others to make that happen. But for those that want to, that we should reinvest in, we should, you know, look for folks who want to start businesses and who are looking to come into the city to live, we should help them to get those houses. For the places that should be repurposed, again, new businesses, but also other things like rec centers. You know, we can take blocks and convert them into places where kids can play, where we can do hydroponics, things like that, right here in an urban community like Baltimore. Other things that we could do, we can have tax incentives where we encourage folks who have been sitting on vacant lots and vacant homes for a long time to either invest or divest. So if your home is sitting there vacant, if you're living in Florida and you're just holding on to these properties, well, I'm going to skyrocket your property tax and then take the asset and repurpose it in a way that is beneficial for the city. Obviously, that's going to require some legislative changes, but it can be done. But with regards to funding for all of this, the reality is that, you know, the city budget is in a bad shape. We need to first and foremost do audits of our city government before we can know exactly where our resources are and then make the decision on how we want to allot it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Young. Ms. Embry, your plan for vacant housing in Baltimore.
Thank you. And it's important to remember that vacant housing not only destroys neighborhoods, but costs the city money on a daily basis, from police and fire to boarding up houses to crime and safety. There are four points that I'd like to make. The first is effective management. The city, since instituting vacancy to values, which intellectually makes sense, has 500 more vacant houses than when it started. So we have to have a process that works and is turbocharged and driven with a sense of urgency, so that at the end of my term, we won't have 500 more vacant houses, we'll have 1,000 less. And that's about effective management. The second is increasing access to capital, and that's working with programs like Healthy Neighborhoods to make sure that instead of having $40 million in capital for renovation houses, we have $100 million or $200 million. And that's working with banks and the private sector. The third is making sure that we're involving communities in the planning of their neighborhoods. And that means also giving them direct access to capital, bringing back the Dollar Home Program and the Homesteading Loan Fund so that people have access to develop houses on their own. It also means involving communities by creating green space and having the ability to hold on to land through land trusts. Which brings me to the final point, which is preserving affordable housing. As neighborhoods develop, we need to make sure that there's housing for all. And that returns me to the idea of land trusts and other mechanisms to make sure that we have affordable housing in perpetuity so that everyone in this city benefits from the redevelopment of vacants, not just the lucky few. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Embry. Now, for the second set of candidates, would any of you care to respond for 30 seconds on the issue of vacant housing? And we'll take this in order, Mr. Stokes.
Sure. The other candidate made some great points. We need to make every house productive. There's a lot of vacant properties in Baltimore City that lease to crime. And in high crime areas, a lot of people do not want to invest. So, of course, our vacant issues is in line with all the issues we have in Baltimore City. But in all together, we need to make it productive, make it safe if it's unsafe, and collectively work with the communities to make it better in our communities. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Care to comment?
Yes, I think we should revisit the current policy that they have on vacant houses, but I haven't heard anyone talking about rehab any of these houses for disability people. I've never heard that part of the conversation. So I'm wondering here, when they talk about this invention of capitals and all of this investment, where are the ordinary people fit into this? Where does the low-income people who wants to own a house fit into this? I don't hear anyone talking about them, and they are the backbone of our city.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Mr. Warnock?
You know, we can put hundreds of people to work doing demolition, refurbishment, and recycling of our housing stock in Baltimore City. It takes about 125 people to take down and recycle 200 houses. We've got 16,000 vacant houses, and if you solve for X, that's 10,000. I started a company by the name of Green Job Works that's 40% owned by the Center for Urban Families and 60% owned by the management. We have 125 people doing demolition and recycling in Baltimore City. The solution is what I've been doing for a long time.
Thank you, Mr. Warnock. Ms. Dixon?
Thank you. First, let me encourage people to go on my website and take a look at an extensive plan called Shared Prosperity and Vibrant Neighborhoods. Actually, the Sun Paper complimented that plan. But in that plan, it has a whole section about vacant properties, and it's through land bank. The city does not have thousands of dollars, millions of dollars, but we have property and we have land. And through a land bank that I studied for a number of years, it's working in Cleveland, it's working in Detroit, where we give you an individual or a developer.
Thank you, Ms. Dixon. Well, now I have the second question, which will be addressed to the second group of candidates. It concerns property taxes. The property tax rate in the city of Baltimore is more than double the rate of surrounding counties. Anne Arundel County is 2.3, Baltimore County 2.75, Baltimore City 5.6%. Why have we gotten to this point, and what do you propose to do about it? And then this question from a member of our audience, has anyone looked at converting from a property tax to a land value tax? Many economists believe that a land value tax will encourage development while decreasing taxes on residents and housing. Mr. Stokes.
Thank you. I do understand the land value tax. Currently, we'd have to change state law to go to that, but I do understand that you put the greater value on the land itself. So regardless of whether it's a vacant lot or whether it's a castle, you're going to pay the same amount of tax based on the land value as opposed to the improvement on the property. Having said that, I think my third or fourth bill coming back to the city council was a bill that said we would cut the Baltimore City property tax rate by 50% over the next 5 years. That bill was never heard by the city council. I wasn't even given the courtesy of it coming into committee to be spoken about. I believe, and I've said, and on my website, carlstokes2016.com, I speak to the fact that I would, as mayor, cut the property tax in Baltimore City by 50% over the next 5 to 8 years. And it's about a penny equals $3 million in this city. So 15 cents in the first year, for example, would be cutting the budget by $45 million with the audits that I will be doing regularly. It is not a big deal, a $3 billion budget, to find the first 15 cents to cut our property tax. It will spur development and investment in the city. It will spur new home ownership and new jobs by businesses being created and expanded. I absolutely will, in the first few months of my term, bring forward a plan to cut the property tax in half.
Thank you, Mr. Stokes. Mr. Cupid.
Carl, that's assuming you win, right? But great point, audits. You know, we definitely need to conduct audits. Find out where we're spending our money, okay? Once we fix our budget, then we can look on how we can reduce property taxes responsibly. In Baltimore City, we have a lot of issues, and finances is one of those issues we have. So while I'm committed to reducing property taxes as a whole, because I pay a hefty tax bill myself, I want to also ensure that we have good services in the city. The land value that you asked about, I haven't considered it myself, but what I am dedicated to is reducing taxes and making it more affordable to residents in the city. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper. Mr. Wilson.
Thank you. Before I came to this country, I was an accountant, and that gave me great pleasure to look into the tax and how it's being calculated in this city. And it's very interesting. You can't follow it at all. I'm like, what's going on here? But so I think that the easiest way to cut taxes in this city is to let everybody understand it very easily. I believe that we could cut taxes by reduce tax You pay taxes every month. So you pay 11 and a half months for the first 2 years, and then 11 months for the next 2 years if I'm there for 4 years, and we see how that works. So in that way, you will get that tax free at least a month or a year. So, you know, if you pay from January to November, you get December off. You can use that money for Christmas gift and all that. Now, to generate back the funds that we're going to lose from that 1 month, I propose that we increase taxes on parking in the city. If you live in the city and you can prove that you live in the city, it won't affect you who live in the city, but people who visit the city. I think we should tax hotels, bedroom and boarding. We can increase taxes on that too to generate back taxes on that. Also, we could definitely increase the cost for illegal dumping and all of these other illegal things that they do that we can generate tax and be forceful on that. So I think that the best way to reduce tax is the way I think.
Mr. Warnock, your plan for property taxes?
Well, it's election season, and politicians will promise a lot of things, including big cuts in property taxes. The reality is that we've got to get a handle on our financing in Baltimore City. We need somebody that's got a business mind to take a look at what we're spending money on. I've been on audit committees, on many audit committees. If you look at what we're spending money on in Baltimore City, I mean, look at what Gregory Thornton found when he went to North Avenue. He went to North Avenue and found $3.6 million worth of annual expenses in ghost employees and spouses that weren't spouses on the health care plan. That's in the Baltimore Sun. And we haven't done an audit of our municipal functions since William Donald Schaefer was the mayor of this city. The little mini transportation audit that came out of so-called audit used words like guesstimate. And I know enough about gap accounting that that is not a gap accounting term. It is not a gap accounting term. We need a business person. Because if you look at the perversity of what's going on in our public schools right now, where the funding from Annapolis is going down, where property values are going up, because we simply got out-negotiated by a bunch of developers who got TIFs that allowed them not to pay taxes, but property values went up, and the cash that we got from Annapolis went down. We need someone with a business mind to handle this now.
Thank you, Mr. Warnock. Ms. Dixon?
Thank you. In my Shared Prosperity and Vibrant Neighborhoods plan, we have to be responsible when we reduce property tax. We need to do it annually, but we have to do it responsibly based on the fiscal layout of Baltimore City. For every penny that we reduce in the property tax, that's $100. For 50 cents, it would be $170 million that we have to find annually. As I mentioned earlier, when we talked about vacant properties, so a land bank, when we can leverage properties to individuals or developers and we remove those liens, then they will be able to leverage that to enhance and increase neighbors and communities, as well as the tax incentives. We have to balance the tax incentives. We have to balance it in neighborhoods that at this time are not getting access to that so that we can attract development in additional communities. Because as we grow communities, we are able to grow additional revenue. Last but not least, the Horseshoe Casino. The reason why I supported the Horseshoe Casino was for two purposes. One, it was a new revenue source that was supposed to go for reducing the property tax, and two, for education. And currently, that's not happening. And with a new revenue source, it's an ideal way in order to reduce property tax.
Thank you, Ms. Dixon. Mr. Mosby, would you care to comment on property taxes?
Yes, I encourage the audience to go to my website, Mosby for Mayor, and read my tax reduction plan. I'm the only person on the stage that's put forth specific proposal on exactly how I'm going to cut taxes. The one thing when we talk about the comparison of Baltimore City taxes to our neighboring counties is comparing apples to oranges. Right now, in that tax rate, we have fees like the trash fee. I call on the city to develop and itemize and pulling it out so we can really compare apples to apples and rates to rates. We need to develop a tiered tax structure for our vacant and dilapidated homes. And lastly, we need to drive more governmental accountability to drive efficiency.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez. Property taxes.
Yeah, so in addition to looking at lowering property taxes, which is going to require a lot of work from a lot of people, as the mayor, I'm going to make sure to improve the value that we're getting for the high property taxes that we're paying. With that, as much as we're paying in property taxes, we should have neighborhoods that are clean. Our potholes should be fixed. We should have more trees planted in our neighborhood. We should have more well-lit streets. And we should have more quality after-school programs for our kids. That's what I will focus on, is improving the day-to-day management of our people, our money, and our processes to ensure that those things take place.
Ms. Walsh, do you care to comment on property taxes?
If you read the school bond issue, the AAA rating that was attached to it attaches to all of the city's tax revenue for decades, and that is written so vaguely that will mean property tax. And we're having a bond market collapse with the Fed rising rates, which means that those bonds and our taxes will be tied forever to that. There's no lowering. I am about reviewing the bonds, seeing that they're written in public interest, and that is the only way we'll be able to be free of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Walsh. Mr. McKesson.
So we should consider an annual decrease in the property tax after we review the budget. One of the things that I've realized when I talk to so many people is that people feel like there's no investment on the property tax, that people are paying all this money and they aren't in safe neighborhoods, and the kids don't go to safe schools. And that's what we need to address as well, is making sure there's a real reinvestment on the property tax and also consider an annual decrease in the property tax after review the budget itself.
Thank you, Mr. Young.
Yeah, I'll reiterate my comment on the audits and how we have to focus on, you know, fixing the budget first. But, you know, I think we have an opportunity in this election to be very bold. There are a lot of people who have been in political office and have had the opportunity to make the changes that we have known we need to make for a very long time. We have too many candidates that are up here for us to go back to the same old policies, the same old people who are telling us the same old thing. And I'm hoping to give you guys a viable alternative, somebody who is authentic and someone who has real genuine interest and a business mind to be able to get the job done for Baltimore.
Thank you, Mr. Young. Ms. Embry, property taxes.
Thank you. Our city is too heavily reliant on property tax revenue. It's not healthy for our city, and it makes us uncompetitive. But getting out of it means being fiscally responsible, disciplined, and predictable. And that means, as mayor, I will stay committed to the current mayor's committed reduction, and beyond that, I will commit and be disciplined in reducing property tax rates as we see increases in other sources of revenue, so that we change the balance in the city so that we're not so heavily reliant on property tax revenue. But it requires discipline, it requires prosperity, and it requires commitment.
Thank you. We'll now move to another question. This is for the first group of candidates, and it concerns the issue of racial inequality. There are dramatic racial and socioeconomic disparities in our city. There are, in many ways, two Baltimores. One in which, for example, a child born in Sandtown Winchester has a much lower life expectancy than a child born in Roland Park. As mayor, what will you do to address these disparities, and what specific policy initiatives do you propose to improve this situation? Mr. Rosen.
A lot of times we talk about the systemic and structural issues at play in our city when we talk about crime, when we talk about black, when we talk about the school system. But one question that we do not do well with is going after poverty. And that's the single most root of all of the systemic issues at play in our city. Until we're able to drive equity into our communities, again, building off of strength. When we have folks that are living in East and West Baltimore, who purchased homes 20 and 30 years ago, and their property value is less today than it was when they purchased then. That's a problem. We know that from a working class and middle class family perspective, the single biggest investment a lot of times is your home. And the single biggest access to growth and capital and wealth is through your home. And the failed policies of the leaders of the past has contributed and exacerbated this issue throughout East and West Baltimore. Another problem that we have to really focus with in our communities is lead paint poisoning. The fact that in 2016 we have children in East and West Baltimore, hundreds of them, that are being plagued by lead paint poisoning on a yearly basis is a problem. These are the challenges that have plagued our city for far too long, and it's up to us to come together. That's why this election is so important. You know, these things that we talk about over and over and over again that we've seen for far too long, it's time for us to really develop the plans and the challenges. That's why my comprehensive plan is a 15-point plan that really goes after those challenges, like lead paint poisoning, like developing early childhood educational opportunities, like getting to the root of these fundamental issues around poverty that directly drive our systemic issues in our community.
Thank you, Mr. Mosley. Mr. Gutierrez, on the issue of racial inequality, what specific policy initiatives do you propose?
Yes, well, in many cases in this city, the difference between the haves and the have-nots comes down to access to quality resources. We have not done anywhere near the job we need to making sure that children across the city have access to the resources they need to succeed. One of the things we're going to do is expand pre-K and make it universal across the city. That's going to do two things. It's going to improve kindergarten readiness, and it's also going to diversify our classrooms, because we can't keep putting the poor black kids in one class all by themselves and expect them to do as well as the diverse classes that we see all across the city. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to rework the school curriculum completely to make sure that it meets the needs of today's children in our specific environment. The cookie-cutter academic approach is not working. We need to incorporate things like mental health and wellness, because everybody might not grow up to be a scientist, but we want everybody to grow up to be healthy. We need character coaching. We need life skills training. And we're also going to expand vocational education training, but we are going to start it in the sixth grade. Because by the time children arrive to middle school, if the academic approach isn't working out for them currently, their only recourse is to drop out and head down a wrong path. We want to give them as many opportunities to participate in a productive society by earning a trade that they can use to raise their family and stay away from crime.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez. Ms. Walsh, on the issue of racial and socioeconomic disparities.
My platform is about removing the connection of every Baltimore City agency from two powerful institutions who control all of the development. People might not be aware, but every agency in our city is attached to a global corporation. If you're going to remove yourself from those corporate entities and rebuild those public agencies out into all of the communities, you are right there going to build that equity. If you are somebody who recognizes the federal equal protection, you're going to not only fight for those federal funds that are supposed to come to the state but often don't, you're going to get them here, you're going to see that they're distributed equally, whether it's education, whether it's health care, protecting our water from privatization because it's going to be the poor that are affected the most. Those are the kinds of things. You want the city to have a place for every citizen. I am completely about rebuilding the public justice system in the city. We have none. We have no public justice system that looks at government corruption, at the criminal justice system and the injustice in criminal charges on citizens that need to be stopped and corrected in many cases. I will do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Walsh. Mr. McKesson, on the issue of racial and socioeconomic disparity.
So much of the work in these areas are not a matter of what to do, it's how do we do it at scale. When I think about three buckets, I think about so many of these disparities start at birth. So when we think about the 0-3 cohort, we can actually make a citywide strategy around Head Start, and 4-5 is a citywide strategy around pre-K, making sure that kids who need access have access to those services. We can do that. And home visits are something that in the city we've seen have demonstrable results, we just haven't seen it at scale. And home visits are really important because we can address things like lead paint, we can make sure kids have their first libraries, we can get to child literacy. We can do that with the home visit strategy. And a job strategy is a second bucket, a job strategy that focuses on skill development and access to resources. So with skill development, you know, in the city upwards of 30% of adults are illiterate, and we have to address the adult illiteracy rate if we're ever going to make a skill-based progress with relationship to jobs. And then the third is something I'm always fascinated about, this idea of health beyond hospitals. When so many people think about health, they think about people going to the hospital. But so much of what it means to be healthy is the stuff that you do every day. the hospital is only a small part of what that means. So we think about public health campaigns around HIV, around chronic illnesses. We can actually do that work. And those disparities are things that we've logged in communities, but again, so much of the way the public thinks about it and the policy thinks about health is centered on hospitals. And we can actually flip that script there in ways that we've seen be demonstrable in communities. And so much of it too is about how do we think about health, not just with people who access services in communities, but think about community health in a broader way, not just focused, again, on people who access services. And we've seen that work happen across the country, and we can do that here as well.